So I'm going to quickly introduce myself, and then I'll let everyone talk a little about their companies and what they do, and we'll jump right into it. So venture capital investor, Intel Capital. I tend to focus our investing on what we call, you know, early growth, and what that means is, you know, companies that have product market fit, early customers, but really before they growth inflect. And given that, I spend a lot of time thinking about what are the right signals we should be looking for? What are the right signals that tells a company that, hey, they're growing and inflecting and on the right path and things are looking good and you can start to add money and capital and that leads to great things. And we've heard from a lot of great people here today about all of the metrics they track, the things that are important, their cohorts, all that great stuff. And some of the things that we're going to focus here on this panel is what were the right signals and maybe what were the wrong signals and how to differentiate the two. You know, everything from, hey, and we get conflicting messages all the time. Is it users and growth? Is it revenue? Or what's the right mix and balance? So that's really what I want to talk about here. And I'm going to let the panel introduce themselves, tell you a little bit about themselves and the company. And I'm going to ask each one of you to, in addition to that introduction, also tell us the one thing Lloyd did to get you to come to this conference. Ready? Let's do it. Because Lloyd's sort of a growth hacker here as well in this scene.
Okay. My name is Alan Lau, CEO and co-founder of Wattpad. Wattpad is a free app and website that lets people read and share stories. Stories can be your personal travel stories or a fictional story like science fiction or fan fiction. And through this app, we built a community of 40 million monthly users, and we are based in Toronto. So to answer your question, what he did was send me a very short email, three lines, very precise, and get me hooked. So I reply, and then we get the conversation going, and that's why I'm here.
All right. Yeah.
Hey there, I'm Dinesh. Work at Udemy. Udemy's a marketplace for online courses. We've got about 7 million students learning with us, 25,000 courses to take in. How many of y'all have taken a course on Udemy? Anybody got that? All right, we got a couple. Awesome. So quickly on me, I was the first business guy at Udemy. I've been there a little over 4 years, responsible for a mix of our marketing and operations. So marketing on both sides of the marketplace, demand and supply side, and our customer support. What did Lloyd do to bring us over? It was a lot of just pushiness, and it was a little awkward, and just come for 24 hours, and I'm here. And I'm leaving on a flight in an hour and a half, which I will hopefully make.
Hey, guys. Hi, guys. I'm Mada, and I'm with a company called Branch Metrics, so with a much younger company than these guys. But they're both customers of ours, so we're excited about that. So we're a mobile deep linking solution that basically, imagine finding a pair of awesome shoes in your favorite app, sharing them with your friend. They don't have the app. Now they go to the App Store, they install it, and right after, they're not taken to those awesome shoes that you sent them. So if they use one of our links, we deep link them to the shoes, and we tell the app developer where every user came from. So we're basically making mobile app experiences seamless and better. A little bit about me. I'm one of the co-founders, and I run the marketing team, which is everything from doing events and writing blogs and building the brand. How Lloyd got to me. I run a pretty large meetup in the Bay Area called Mobile Growth Hackers. We have about 3,000 people in our group. And I think Lloyd reached out to me on Meetup, sent me a direct message, and I replied, and then we took it from there.
Awesome. Yeah, so you got to know your audience. Lloyd got to me with the first line of his email was, 2 free drink tickets, come to Vancouver. That's all I needed to know, and I was here. If it was 1 free drink ticket, I wouldn't have come, but for 2, I'm here. So, all right, let's get to our topic. So what I wanted to talk about is, let's start with, what are the key metrics in your business that you're tracking, and what are the key metrics that you think are most important that are really giving you the positive indications that, hey, you're onto something and the growth is good, right? And I'll try to attest later that not all growth is good, but some growth is good. And I'm going to start with you, Dinesh, because I know we chat a bit, but give me a little sense for what are the key metrics you think that are showing to you that your growth is good growth.
Yep. So
We have really two top-level goals as a company. It's revenue and it's student happiness. And for everybody out there, you know, anything you hear from me, I would think of it through the eyes of, we think of ourselves as a marketplace and a mix of kind of an e-commerce business and a marketplace, right? So the things that I may be saying may be dead wrong for other types of businesses, and hopefully these guys will add on to that. The metrics we look at on the revenue side, revenue's pretty straightforward, right? It's actual purchases. One of the things that was really interesting for us that we learned on revenue was that you need to actually look at a mix of the quantity and quality of users that you're acquiring. So for quite a while, we goaled on just the sheer number of users that we would acquire. But across the various channels through which you acquire users, you can acquire folks who monetize extremely well or extremely poorly. So we started goaling on a metric that we call new user revenue, which is essentially the month one revenue, the total month one revenue we get from all the users we acquire in a given month. Think of it essentially as the first month of a cohort. And that really started to have a dramatic effect on how we looked at our user acquisition, which channels were performing the most. On the happiness side, we goal on MPS. We look at both the MPS of Udemy, how likely are you to recommend Udemy to a friend or colleague, and also the MPS of a given course, how likely are you to recommend that course to a friend or colleague.
Okay, so everyone know what MPS is? Hands? Anyone not?
Net promoter score on a scale of 0 to 10, how likely are you to recommend X to friend or colleague? Sum up all the 9s and 10s, minus the 0 through 6s, divide by total respondents. We found that NPS was one of the strongest indicators for us of student happiness, and we ultimately found that folks who enrolled into better courses, higher MPS courses, go on to have higher LTVs on Udemy. So we connected that link between happiness and revenues, which I think just helped all of our teams be a lot more aligned.
Got it. So it's interesting, and I want to hear now how you think about it, Alan, because you have a little bit of a different business than say, Udemy. So same question. What are the key metrics you think about that are the most important to know that, you know, you've got good growth?
I'm a big fan of pick a single metric and that the entire company is focusing on. That metric has not changed a lot over time. Wattpad is an 8-year-old company. When we first started in 2006, we were using number of users, MAU, monthly active users, as our number one metric, and that did not change over time. But there are a few nuances. Like 2 years ago, for a period of time, we changed that to daily signups because we felt that the top end of the funnel is not strong enough. We want to put more focus on daily signups, but the goal is to still drive the monthly active users. And today, that goal has changed a bit. MAU is still our number one goal, but as we start to monetize, we have a secondary company goal. We look at revenue as well, but it's very clear to the entire company, MAU is our number one goal, revenue is secondary. If there's any conflict, we use that order to decide which one we prioritize.
And Mada, how about you? How do you think about our branch metrics?
Yeah, so we're a little bit different because we're not focused on consumers, we're focused on mobile app developers. So we also kind of go by that. We have one metric, and that metric is how many live integrations we have. So how many apps have used Branch to power their links and are live in the App Store. That being said, to track happiness, we're very fanatical about support, and we want literally every app developer that has a question to be answered in like the first hour or two of them asking it. Hopefully these guys can attest for that. So we track our number of support requests and our response time. I think we're trying to get that to zero. We're building like some awesome documentation. So that's why that's a very important metric for us. But at the end of the day, the one metric is number of integrations.
So it's interesting. So Dinesh, it sounds like for you, primary is revenue. For you, Alan, primary is MAU. And for you, Mata, it's integrations, right? So three very different metrics. And, you know, let me ask a question. For the types of businesses in your given sectors, do you think you're unique, or is that what you see your peers also looking at as a primary metric for a similar type of business in what you're doing?
I think in our space, mainly in the social networking community space, the most popular business model is advertising. And to generate more advertising inventory, the number of users really matters. So that's why those two are closely correlated to each other. I don't think we are very unique in terms of how we think of this. But I also want to emphasize the number of users or revenue. They are not the only two metrics that we look at. We look at hundreds of different metrics. But they, number one, they are all in support of the one or two company goals. That's very important. And number two, we talk about data science is that as well. And if you only look at numbers, the numbers, they don't tell you the whole story. So we look at things qualitatively as well. For instance, we would spend time to look at what users are commenting or what messages they're sending, posting on Wattpad, you know, both quantitatively and qualitatively to understand the sentiment. Not that different than the NPS that other companies are looking for instance.
And a question for you, Mata, you know, other than NPS and other than, you know, sort of this qualitative measure, how do you know your customers are happy? And how are you measuring that?
I guess the one way is to understand if they're referring other customers to us. So actually our biggest channel is word of mouth referrals. Developers tend to be like that. If they love a product, they'll tell all their buddies about it. So we don't ask them, we don't measure NPS, but we measure what percentage of our users come from referrals, and it's incredibly high. So that's one way. And then the other way, we email them and we ask them, hey, would you be willing to like write something about us or tell your friends? And we measure the response rate of that, and it's almost 100%. So I think that's kind of how we do it. But we're also a lot earlier on, so we haven't gotten to a place where we standardize like measuring NPS.
Were you going to add something, Dinesh? I didn't want to cut you off.
Yeah, I was going to just tack on to what Alan was saying a little bit earlier. We were catching up just outside, and there are a lot of similarities between Udemy and Wattpad. You know, both user-generated content businesses, both marketplaces in a sense, both media formats, right? Online courses versus books almost, right? And reading. But there are two pretty big differences we identified, and I think those differences actually drive the reasons behind why we goal a little bit differently, right? And the differences are the way that we monetize. Udemy does a revenue share off of course sales. Alan does advertising, right? And the second difference is the needs of the supply side of our marketplaces. Right. On Udemy's side, our instructors are very passionate about their courses and want to be able to share their knowledge with folks, but they also want to be able to earn an income from their courses, and they want to be able to build businesses. And Alan was saying it's a little bit different on his end. It's more about building an audience and a following and celebrity, less about building a business. And I think that kind of plays out in the goals, right? That's some of why we focus more on revenue and some of why they focus more on MAUs. Yep.
That's right. Very, very helpful and insightful. You know, one of the things that, you know, that I want to shift a bit to is what I said at the onset, which is, you know, I've certainly invested and been on boards of companies where we thought the thing was growing and scaling, but there's some underlying assumption that was wrong. So an example, one specifically, you know, freemium company where we sort of had the assumption of a certain conversion rate of free to paid and thought that really what we wanted was just as many free users as we could get. We just wanted more audience and more audience. And, you know, when that underlying assumption was wrong, you know, recognized we were just acquiring the wrong customers, people were never going to pay, right? And in that case, we had to, you know, shift how we were thinking about acquiring customers to get a different type of customer. So my question for the panel is, you know, you've been building businesses for a long period of time now. What were some of the metrics that perhaps you were looking at and were getting you excited early on, and as time has gone on, as you've matured, maybe you've recognized that perhaps those weren't the right metrics to have focused on, and you know, and over time you've shifted that your thinking. And do you want to start out?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, early on, we bootstrapped the company for many years. We started in 2006. But we raised our Series A in 2011. There was a tiny seed round in between, but for the longest time, we had to focus a bit on revenue because I have to eat. So when we raised our Series A, there were two metrics that we look at, both revenue, you know, we need to be self-sustaining, but also look at the MAU. But once we raised our Series A, we quickly realized, if we put too much focus on the revenue, then it would, it can actually be harmful to the company, because at the end, the company, how I can drive the enterprise value, how I can make this company more impactful is we have to have more users. So our focus, at least our mental focus, immediately put more focus on driving the user growth, and that has been the case since we raised our A round until pretty much like a year ago when we figure out different business models, and it's becoming very clear that advertising is our first and a very important business model. And once we realized that we set the number two goal in the company, revenue as our number two goal in the company, so it's kind of going full circle. But you know, at different stage of your company, you have to focus on different things in a way so that you maximize the enterprise value, maximize the growth opportunity.
Yeah, so I mentioned earlier probably one of the biggest revelations for us, which is not just focusing on the total number of users we acquire, but essentially focusing on the number of users acquired multiplied by your month one retention metric. And that when you do that, you're going to end up doing a much better job of stacking cohorts. And I think if you kind of extrapolate, for us, the retention metric's revenue, but if you extrapolate it out to just to a retention metric, it can work almost for any business. The other thing that's maybe worth mentioning here is we have forecasted out what we thought our retention would look like on various user acquisition channels and been wildly wrong on those forecasts, depending on the channel. So particularly early on in the business, I think you have to be very careful with that forecasting until you have months or years worth of cohort and retention data to really know what you're doing there. And a simple example for us, multiple different times we tried to make paid acquisition work for the business. How do we go out and actually spend dollars on Facebook and AdWords and so on and so forth? And failed at it probably three separate times over the last 4 years. And only in the past sort of 9 months have we really gotten it to work. And I think part of getting it to work, there are a variety of factors going into that, but part of why it didn't work early on is we didn't really understand how our cohorts were going to grow. So we weren't able to apply the appropriate ROI goals and thresholds and payback periods back when we were running them very early on, when the average user had only been on Udemy for 6 months' time, something like this.
And just out of curiosity, when you say it didn't work, was it that you weren't getting, you weren't able to acquire the customers, or it was just too expensive to acquire through the paid channels?
It was the ROI wasn't there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, I mean, if you pay enough, you can acquire lots of customers, right? So, you know, we had certain standards. We were trying to hit a payback period of 6 months. And I think generally folks aspire to have an LTV of CAC to CAC of 3-to-1 ratio. And we were pushing for this, but you can start spending a lot of unprofitable dollars if you don't know what your ROIs look like on day one, day seven, day 30, and then how they're ultimately gonna end up trending toward your payback period. And you need months and years of cohort data to really understand that stuff properly, and you also need it by channel. And it took us a bunch of time to get that and to be able to set the right goals there.
Yeah. And you're obviously a little bit of a younger company, but I'm curious, you know, things you've learned over time and that
I think it's really interesting. I think for us, from the very beginning, we were very focused on using our links for referrals, and we were like, we really believed that we were just building mobile referral systems for apps. And we were just focused so much on that and how many people are using us for a referral system, and we built like a whole referral program on top of our links. And we never, like in the first like early months, we didn't stop to see how people were actually using our product and looking at the data until like much later on. And when we look back, we saw that only, I think it was only like 15% of our apps were using us for referrals, and everyone else was building all these cool things. They were building personalized installs and sharing of content, and we realized at that point that we were actually a very different company than we thought we were. We were not just a referral company, we were like this linking company, and we started focusing a lot more on that and being more general and not just going on to like one use case for our links. But it's interesting, like in the early days you think you know what your customers want. And what was interesting is we were only talking to a few of those early customers, you know, who were our friends and who were interacting with, but we didn't look at all the people who were discovering on their own and using us on their own. So when we started, like, we didn't have time to like go and look at all our data. We were growing so fast. When we went back and looked at that, it gave us such an interesting insight into how people are using us that almost like changed the way we started looking at our business.
So, you know, given you're a fairly young company, you probably don't have years and years and years of data to measure cohorts and success, you know, all the things that Dinesh was talking about. How do you get confidence and conviction around, you know, the things you're looking at are right or are trending the right way in the long term? You know, what is it that gives you the confidence to know that, hey, the customers you're acquiring are going to be long-term customers and you know, and you can build all your models around that?
Yeah, I mean, we're a pretty sticky product. When an app uses us and starts using us, we're the linking platform, so they use us for all the links. And we look at, one thing we look at is there's so many ways you can use our links. It could just be for a referral program, or it can be just to do sharing, it could be deep linked ads. And it's funny, like what sometimes people start by just using us to do a test for one part, and then we see ourselves growing and they start using us. So for example, Hotel Tonight started by just testing some deep link ads with us. And then they build their whole referral program with us. And now they're building hotel sharing with us. So when we see that a company uses us for something and then they start using us to build new features into their app, that's how we know that we're actually doing something right and they like our products. So that's kind of, yeah.
So you all have raised money from investors, and you know, oftentimes what an investor is looking for, or usually just is growth, 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 but maybe not quite sure exactly what that means. Has there been instances where you've been at odds with what the investor thinks they're looking for and what you're educating about what they should be looking for? Right? Has that ever posed a conflict in terms of, you know, your investor or your board is saying this is what you need, but you understand your business is you need something different, and how you resolve that?
It's been quite aligned all along, but like I mentioned, at around Series A time, we kind of shifted more focus on the user growth, and that, actually that came from our investors. In fact, when we before we raised Series A, we had a lot more display advertisement on our website. Our website looked horrible at that time, but we had to make money, so we had those horrible display ads on our website. And our investor from Union Square actually asked me, hey, Alan, do you mind we put a clause into the term sheet? You have to promise you remove all your display advertisements. So I was thinking, wait a minute, he is asking me to go from a revenue-generating company to a zero-revenue-generating company? Really? But when I think more about this, it actually makes sense. At the end, we didn't remove all the display advertisement because we did some A/B tests. We didn't feel like we have to remove all of them, but we reduced the number of ads per page and stuff like that to find the right optimal user experience and revenue. If you are looking for a conflict between investor and entrepreneurs, that would be one example that I use.
I love hearing about new venture capital term sheet investor tricks, so that's great. Now I know a new one.
So on our side, we've been kind of focused on revenue almost from day one, right? So not a lot of misalignment there with investors. We did learn from investors over time, what are the key health metrics that you want to look at, particularly in a marketplace business, to understand if things are working well, right? So obviously folks have talked about just basic ones like cohort retention metrics, and you can look at retention across various metrics. But a couple of the more interesting ones that we started focusing on, and we don't really goal on these metrics, but we look at them fairly frequently and understand the health of how they're doing, and we have goals that we think drive them. So there are things like concentration of revenues in the business. So what percent of revenues are in what percent of your supply or in what percent of your demand? And this varies for different types of businesses. There are things like cross-pollination. So in a marketplace business where, you know, like Udemy, where there are multiple different categories of courses available, how many students are actually purchasing courses across multiple categories? Is it valuable to have multiple categories and to be a marketplace, or is it just not that valuable? And we've obviously found it's quite valuable, and we have students taking courses across those categories, but it's very important to look at. And then turnover in the marketplace as well has been a really interesting metric to look at. So a supply side metric that helps you understand, as more supply comes into the marketplace, does that supply get success? Does it go on to be the most used supply or the most purchased supply? So are you seeing a lot of turnover? And marketplace businesses, one of the things that's really powerful about them is they generate a lot of supply. They generate a whole lot more supply than you can in a non-marketplace business. So are you seeing the benefits and the power of that? So those were interesting.
Anything else? Yeah, go ahead, Mata.
I think for us, it was very similar to Alan. I think every other company that's kind of in this mobile attribution space charges, and we're free. And we have this like really long-term vision of helping change app discovery. And in order to grow and be in every app in the App Store, we need to be free. So we are very worried that if we go to our investors and we tell them that, they wouldn't be that supportive. But surprisingly, they're actually very supportive of that, because I think they buy into the long-term vision. And now when we go and we say, maybe we should charge for something, they're always the ones to say, no, focus on growth now. Don't focus on monetization this early on. So we've been very aligned, I think. But we're also earlier on, so that might change. So
I'm getting the signal that we're pretty much out of time. So let's wrap. But maybe one concluding thing that maybe each of you can do is point out something that indicated, that gave you some insight that maybe wasn't obvious, right? So there's a lot of the, you know, revenue users, all the stuff. But is there something that provided signal that was not obvious to you when you first started? And let's do that. And this will be the last thing we do in conclusion. Why don't we start with you, Mata?
Okay, I'll start. So before we were building Branch, we tried to build a different SDK. It was a printing SDK, and we're trying to go to all these apps and convince them that they should use our printing SDK to monetize. And we would go and talk to all of them, And 1 in 10 would be like, yeah, this is kind of interesting. And we thought, oh, yeah, we kind of have product market fit. But when we started talking to people about Branch, every single person we told about Branch wanted it or understood what we were trying to do and said, wow, this could really help me grow. This helps solve a problem. So I think just talking to a lot of people, and you need pretty much almost every person you pitch your product to that is a potential customer to say, yes, I'm interested, because otherwise you don't have product market fit.
Yeah, that's great.
So mine will quickly just be really understand your use case. You'd think about on-demand online courses, and you'd think that almost all of them would be purchased and consumed through Udemy's mobile applications. And we have a whole lot of consumption happening on our mobile applications, and maybe a bunch of y'all use them, but it hasn't rocketed off as much as we'd expect. And the reason is because we have a lot of coding courses on Udemy. So a lot of folks need to be on their laptop and maybe are using two devices. They're programming as they're taking a course. So things can kind of run contrary to how you think they might run, but the nature of that is always comes back to the use case.
Alan?
It wasn't any like wrong signal or anything, but I want to share a story about a feature that we did a couple of years ago. We did inline commenting in our app, and all of a sudden the number of comments increased by 3 times overnight, and we were very happy. But when we looked closer in the comments, like there are a lot of people swearing in the comments, and we were scratching our head and trying to understand why. And what it turned out was we forgot to implement the anti-bullying, anti-trolling feature in there. So the story behind this is the numbers, they don't tell you the whole story. If I look at the numbers, wow, it hits the roof, right? But the problem is the quality of the comment, it dropped drastically. So you really have to pay attention to both quantity and quality and find the balance between the two. And even at scale, when you have a ton of data, you can still sample. There's nothing replacing talking to your users or customers directly to get that qualitative feedback.
That's great. Hopefully you can help YouTube with their commenting one day as well. But thank you so much. I think we'll have a couple more things before cocktails, but big round of applause for our panel. These guys are awesome. Thank you.
All right.